right, now we're joined by Abby Waller, who's with the Yes on Initiative 124 campaign. So go ahead with up to 5 minutes to talk about why we should vote yes.
Great, thanks so much, Jeff. So I guess I wanted to start just by giving you all a brief overview of what the hospitality industry looks like in Seattle at the moment. I'm going to talk a little bit more about the hotel workforce and their experiences in the city and why we are putting forward this ballot initiative to provide some really basic common sense health and safety protections for workers in the hotel industry in Seattle. So about 7,500 hotel workers employed in Seattle's hotels. Basically, by every metric, the industry is doing incredibly well, whether you look at occupancy, which is a really common metric for measuring how hotels are doing, or room rates. The industry is basically doing better than they ever have. And it's also an industry that's growing rapidly, so there's proposals for 30% growth in the industry over the next 5 years, about 14,000 rooms currently, and that's going to increase significantly, and with it, there are going to be a lot more hotel jobs in the city. And it's also an industry that receives a lot of public support. I think most notably, there's been a proposal for the expansion of the Washington State Convention Center. That's going to be an entirely publicly funded $1.6 billion project. And that's in direct support of the hotel industry in Seattle. And the industry is incredibly important in providing accessible jobs. It's an industry that employs women, people of color, recent immigrants to Seattle. You can get a job as a housekeeper in a Seattle hotel without needing to know a lot of English, without needing a college education. So it's a really great source of jobs for people in our community. Unfortunately, those jobs are incredibly challenging for primarily the women who do them. Hotel housekeeping is one of the hardest jobs out there, both because housekeepers experience what one academic study calls pervasive and normalized harassment from guests, and also just because of the physical toll of doing that work, of making beds, rushing from room to complete, literally hundreds of tasks within each room to clean those rooms and prepare them for guests. The hotel industry also has the lowest rate of employer-offered health insurance of any industry in Washington State, and there's a frequent overturn of both hotel management and hotel ownership, and so that often results in long-term workers being laid off and losing their jobs because a new employer is coming in. And so we put forward Initiative 124 to both recognize the importance of the hospitality industry to Seattle, and also take some steps to make sure that these accessible jobs that we have in our community are safe jobs and are jobs that are providing for the health and safety of primarily the women who work in them. We've sort of centered the campaign around hotel housekeepers, again, because I think their experiences of harassment and also of pain on the job are particularly striking, but these are protections that would apply to workers hotel-wide. A lot of the safety protections are also really important for folks who work in room service because, again, they're having interactions with guests alone in guest suites. And that's sort of been a moment where a lot of the harassment that workers experience has occurred. So I guess I'll talk really quickly about the sort of four provisions of the initiative. The first is around preventing sexual harassment and assault. So it would provide workers with panic buttons, would require posting inside hotel guest rooms saying that Seattle law protects housekeepers and other hotel workers from harassment and assault. And then would create a record-keeping requirement, so if workers are reporting that guests are harassing them, the hotel has to track those reports. And then if there's a sworn affidavit of harassment by a guest, that guest is banned from the hotel. The second piece is around addressing inhumane workloads for housekeepers, so we create a 5,000 square foot limit, that's about 15 hotel rooms, in an 8-hour shift for housekeepers, and there's some reduction too for heavily soiled rooms. When guests check out, those rooms are often dirtier, and so it gives workers a little bit of extra time for those rooms. Third provision is to increase access to affordable family health insurance for workers. Basically gives employers a choice between offering a gold standard of health insurance for no more than 5% of workers' income, or providing some additional compensation to workers so they can purchase their own health insurance on the state exchange. The last provision is job security. So workers aren't laid off when hotels change ownership, but they're given a 90-day chance for the new employer to keep their jobs.
Great, thank you. So now we'll put it up to follow-up questions. People can ask whatever they want. 2-minute answers to each of those, and I'll, and David, and then I have one.
So workloads. Mm-hmm. I've stayed in a lot of hotels, and room sizes are kind of vary from 350 square feet to 600, red courtyard has 3 rooms, others 1. How is this actually, so it's roughly 15 rooms with further reductions, can you elaborate on that a little bit?
Some emergency clinic.
Yeah.
Yeah, so 5,000 square foot limit. I think each hotel is going to figure out based on their room size how many rooms that means for a housekeeper and a shift. And so again, it is going to vary based on the hotel.
It's a 5,000 square foot limit. Mm-hmm. That's what, roughly 15 rooms.
Just roughly 15 rooms, yeah. But the language is actually in the law is the 5,000 square feet to try and keep some consistency. Did that answer your question?
So my question is, what provisions of these law, of this initiative, have been adopted in other jurisdictions around the country, and which ones would we be the first to spearhead the movement, if you will? Mm-hmm.
So there are, and I think this is a movement that's happening across the country for additional protections for housekeepers. So there's a similar effort before the city council in Long Beach, California, currently with both similar sexual harassment protections and also workplace standards. There's talk of a similar effort in Illinois at the state level for hotel and gaming workers. But a lot of these standards are really familiar from union contracts in the hospitality industry, so panic buttons are standard in the 95% of hotels in New York City that are in union. All of those workers have panic buttons. Las Vegas, the same is true for workers in hotel casinos there. But I think it is sort of new ground for it to be city law that workers have these protections from sexual harassment. I think it's really exciting. The other thing I'd say is California, state law in California recognizes what's called third-party harassment, and create some liability for employers to prevent harassment from third parties, from guests, from occurring, and that's sort of at the heart of this protection in Seattle. In terms of the workload standards, Emeryville passed a ballot initiative in 2005, which contained a 5,000 square foot limit for hotel housekeepers. And there have been efforts, section Washington State and California, a few other places, both related to housekeeping and also janitorial work that includes square foot limits. The health insurance language is we would be pioneering here in Seattle. And then worker retention policies are pretty standard. The SeaTac minimum wage law included worker retention. So that's a policy that's in place in the city of SeaTac currently. It's also common for airports and sort of other sort of quasi-governmental jurisdictions have that.
Thank you. Mary?
I have a couple of questions. I guess I'll separate them and not try to do it all at once. What has been the involvement? I assume this is a union-led effort. To what degree have the actual workers been involved in coming up with the ideas for this and in promoting it?
Mm-hmm. So this is an effort that's backed by the United Local 8, the Hospitality Workers Union in Seattle, as well as the King County Labor Council. Has the endorsement of the State Labor Council, so your labor is heavily involved. I think workers have been very involved from the get-go. This has come out of a lot of work organizing numbers around these issues and taking on these sites in union contracts, and we realized that we needed to be looking not just at protecting union workers, but at taking on these issues as they exist throughout the industry, and not just obviously in the hotels with union members. And I think also it comes out of a lot of work that Puget Sound Sage did in 2012, looking at workplace injury for housekeepers, found a rate of injury among hotel housekeepers higher than coal miners. And also they did a lot of work looking at healthcare access among hotel workers, and again saw that their workers were not only facing really high rates of injury on the job, but also didn't have access to affordable family health insurance. And so, yeah, this has been a long time coming. It has involved a lot of organizing and members stepping up and telling really painful stories about harassment that they've experienced on the job, and also the pain that they're living in because of the work that they do every day. In conjunction with the campaign, we did a survey of our members in hotels. Over 100 hotel housekeepers did a survey with us, and 53% of them had experienced some form of harassment. 47% had seen a naked guest at least one time during the course of their work as a housekeeper. And 95% of workers had pain from work and felt pain regularly. And all of that would directly inform the need for this policy and also the specific policy actions that are called for in.
Did you want to do your other question, Clayton?
Sure. I don't imagine that the Chamber of Commerce would be happy about this. And what's the reaction from the business community, and how vociferous are they, and how strongly do they feel? I mean, they've got to realize that there need to be protections for these workers against harassment. What is their reaction? Are they accepting parts of it, not others, or?
And I should say there are employers in Seattle that already do some or a lot of these things that are healthcare that's far above the standard contained in the initiative, that have worker retention policies, that have a 15-room limit on housekeeper workload. So there are good employers in the city that are already doing many of these things. I think we want to level the playing field a little bit so that the folks that they're in competition with are not miles behind. That said, I think that, the opposition we've seen too, it has mostly come from national and state organizations. The American Hotel and Lodging Association is the largest donor so far to the opposition campaign. And then both the state lodging and restaurant associations have been involved. I've not heard anything from the chamber on it or other local business groups.
I don't know how much they did.
Yeah, so I think it is, has largely, at least in terms of the money, been folks from outside Seattle who are scared about what this will mean for the standards of the city.
Quick.
I want to follow up on the drift of some of Mary's questions, especially regarding medical coverage. Mm-hmm. I don't know anything about healthy care or hotel workers. I don't know. For instance, how many hours on average per week they work? How many, what percentage of workers are full time versus half time? Are both full time and part time workers to be accorded health care under this under 124?
So it's 80 hours a month is the what workers would need to work in order to qualify for the healthcare provision. So not full time, but not they have to work. And I would say it's at least housekeeping's 50-60% of the workforce in a hotel. Those tend to be full-time jobs or close to full-time. So those are workers that are proven sufficient hours that they would qualify.
80 hours is about half time. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's 10 days, 8-hour days. And you think people full-time would work in the low 20s, number of days, 5 days a week, mm-hmm. 4 weeks. Can health care kind of good health care plan be provided for what you're suggesting? No more than 6% of that. Well, you want the employer to pay the rest of it.
guess the other thing I would say on the hours issue is that there is also a provision that allows, because many of these workers, particularly in departments like banquets, work at multiple hotels, there is the opportunity for employers basically to share the cost across multiple employers. So it's not all on maybe the employer that worker has the most hours with, but it can be shared.
Okay, I think it should be. I go to an exercise class and our instructor also does banquets and things like that. How would she access it when she's working for this place and that place and the other? How would she get, would she have to be doing 80 hours with one employer to have access to the health care?
She would, yeah, but okay. Then it could be shared with the additional.
Are there, how large of a hotel would a hotel need to be covered by this? Are really small businesses exempted, or can anybody with a hotel license, I don't know if there is such a thing.
Yes, I think the definition of hotel that's sort of laid out in the Seattle City Code is 60 rooms or more. So the harassment provision and the worker retention is going to apply to any hotel with 60 rooms or more, and then the sort of more costly items in the initiative, the health insurance, and the workload standard is meant to be more large hotels, so it's 100 rooms or more for those pieces of it.
Time for a couple more questions. Anybody has them? No, I'd mentioned before we started the interview that I'd invited the no-side interview with us, but had no response. I was wondering if, do you know what some of their biggest talking points are? Like, what are the arguments they're making against this? And then, of course, what would your response be to those?
I don't want to make their arguments for them. I think... certainly an argument that I've seen them make, which I find to be a little bit disingenuous, is that there wasn't, that they weren't given a chance to have input on the initiative. These are their hotels. If they want to implement a policy on addressing sexual harassment or addressing housekeeper workload, they have the absolute right to do that. They could have done that a long time ago, and unfortunately we've seen the failure of the industry to address these issues over a long period of time. And to work with our union and with SAGE and other community groups that have been working to address these issues on coming up with solutions. And they've also said that they want to see a process more like the Seattle minimum wage, where everyone sits down to hash it out. The American Hotel and Lodging Association backed the franchise lawsuit against the Seattle minimum wage. So clearly we're not actually that satisfied with that process when it happened. And, you know, they want to use, again, the threat that they'll file suit against this. I think, you know, we have broad support for the initiative. We've had 30 organizations endorse, over 50 prominent leaders in the city. The Seattle City Council passed a resolution endorsing the initiative. Mayor Murray's endorsed, County Executive Doug Constantine, Pamela Jayapal, Brady Walkinshaw, the progressive leaders of the city are behind this initiative, and folks who've been doing the work to address these issues for women and for immigrants and communities of color in Seattle are behind this initiative, and I'm sorry the hotels feel left out, but if they want to join that coalition, we would be more than welcome to have them.
What about, this is applied just within the city of Seattle?
It's just the city of Seattle.
So what about, Lynnwood, Lake Terrace, they have a lot of big hotels too. Mm-hmm. Did you consider going to a larger area? Because I would imagine one of the arguments against would be that this is going to make the hotels in Seattle more expensive and give the ones in the outlying areas an advantage price wise. Have you heard anything along those lines? Or?
I mean, I think we would absolutely love for this to spread beyond Seattle, and we had to pick a place to start. Mm-hmm. And also, if you look at some of the the public support that I talked about earlier. So the convention center expansion is something that's going to directly benefit the hotels within a 5 or 10 block radius of the convention center. That's going to be a massive boon to the hotels downtown. I think it's going to have less of a positive impact for hotels in Linwood or elsewhere. And so I think we can have higher expectations for these hotels that are, again, benefiting from this public investment.
So we're about out of time. If you want to take 30 seconds for a closing statement.
Sure. I got ahead of myself a little bit. I wanted to leave you with some of the great support that we've had for the initiative. I guess I can share with you also some of the organizations that have endorsed, the New York Times Washington, Casa Latina, LGBTQ Allyship, Northwest Immigrant Joy Project, Puget Sound Sage, a number of labor union labor supporters. Again, there's just incredible consensus that these are common sense protections that hotel workers need, and that Seattle is a city that protects women, and this is a no-brainer for our city.
Great, thank you very much.
Thank you.